This time that we have to fellowship with other believers to celebrate your birthday, Lord. Thank you so much for this day and for this season. And Jesus, it's in your holy name that I pray these things. Amen.
Emmanuel has come. chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloth and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. During this month of Advent, we have been looking at and examining different Christmas movies and trying to draw from them or connect them to the true and actual Christmas story, or at least trying to pull something from them that we can make sense of within the true Christmas story. We started with It's a Wonderful Life, and we found that that life is wonderful only because Jesus was born. Then we looked at a movie which I think is probably new to a lot of you called Surviving Christmas. And that helped us to understand that Christmas isn't something just to be survived. It's not something that we just try to get through or can't wait till December 26th. But that it is something in which we should thrive. And that we thrive at Christmas by focusing on Jesus. And so today, this Sunday before Christmas, I wanted us to look at a movie, to be drawn to something that really takes us to the very heart of the season, to the very reason that we have Christmas. And so today we saw a clip from the Nativity Story. In this movie, if you haven't seen it before, it takes Matthew's account of the birth, it takes Luke's account of the birth, and it brings them literally to life. It traces the lives of Joseph and of Mary from even slightly before Mary found out that she would be the mother of Jesus. And then it traces their lives to this point. It draws in from the wise men and their journey from the east. And then after this point, if you continue on to the end, it brings the shepherds in as they come and worship and pay homage to the baby Jesus. And all of that, the whole movie, the climax is what we saw today, the birth of Jesus himself. And I guess what I felt God tugging on my heart was that this Sunday before Christmas, this fourth Sunday of Advent, this Sunday of love, it needs to be about Jesus. And so we're going to look at the story itself. We'll explore this greatest story ever told and discern some important points that we need to understand from it. You probably have noticed, as you have read Luke's account of the story over the life, over your lifetime, that it is rather succinct. It's short. There's not a lot of flowery description, not a lot of details given. He pretty much just gives us the facts. But it is within that brevity, it is within that concise wording that he uses that makes it so important. Because he uses so few words that the words he uses are things that we ought to listen to. We ought to understand, we ought to know. And they are words then of great importance. And so the first thing that he tells us in the story is that there was a census taken. The Roman government said everyone needed to register. Everyone needed to be accounted for. Now ultimately, or the thought is that as a result of being registered, of accounting for yourself, then the government would levy more taxes upon you. But the idea was just to register, to let them know that you were around. And because Mary had just become betrothed to Joseph, that they were now going to be married, they went together to the home of Joseph's family. The census required everyone go to their ancestral home, and so for Joseph, that was Bethlehem. Now, an interesting thing about Bethlehem, an interesting thing that comes about when we consider that Jesus was born in Bethlehem, is that Bethlehem was originally a Canaanite city. It was named for the Canaanite god Laham, spelled L-A-H-A-M. So it would have been Beth Laham. Well, as Israel came in and overtook Canaan, as they then overtook Bethlehem and made it part of the Israelite promised land, they began to say the word differently. It was no longer Beth Laham, but it became Beth Lehem, L-E-H-E-M. Now, the significance of that is that the word Lehem means bread. So Bethlehem is the city of bread. Okay, so what does that mean? Well, not much until you place it in context with John 6:35, in which Jesus said, "I am the bread of life." And so from this city of bread, we see the bread of life coming forth, being born, coming into the world. We also see that Jesus was born to a woman named Mary. Mary would have been a teenager, a young woman. She would have been recently betrothed to Joseph. She would have been growing up as most normal young women in that day would have. She would have been going through the normal stages of life. And she would have been a virgin. She conceived Jesus not because of anything that she had done, but because of what the Holy Spirit had done to her. She had been with no man. And it is important to understand that she was a virgin when Christ was born. Because she becomes the mother of Jesus. She's not the mother of God, but she is the mother of Jesus. And her virginity is important because it maintains a pure bloodline in Jesus. It maintains a pure and holy line between God the Father and Jesus the Son. It enables Jesus to live a perfect and sinless life. And in living that perfect, sinless, holy life here on earth, then he became the perfect Lamb of God, taken to the slaughter of the cross, paying the debt that we all owed because of our sin. He was able to fulfill his calling on earth, which was to die for his people. Mary then was betrothed to a man named Joseph. Joseph was a carpenter. And from all that we read of Joseph, we seem to understand him as a good and honest man, that he was a man of integrity. Put yourself in his place. You are doing everything right. You have just gotten engaged. You're getting ready to get married to this woman. And by some accounts, tells us in Luke that Mary, after hearing from the angel, she went to Elizabeth for 3 months. So you are separated distance from her for a time of 3 months. And many believe that when she came back, that is when she began to show that she was about 3 months pregnant at that point. So put yourself in Joseph's place. When she left, she was married. The girl that you are going to marry. And after 3 months, she's coming back and you are excited to see her again. And when you see her, there's a little bit more of her. Can you imagine the shock that would have come over him? Can you imagine the heartache that would have come over him? Can you imagine the thoughts running through his mind of what has she done? Who has she been with? Because now she conceivably cannot be with me. And so because of that, Joseph's plan is to divorce her. But because he is a man of integrity, a good man, he decides to do it quietly. And so he makes no accusation against her, because in making that accusation, she would be sentenced to die. And it's not till a few days later, perhaps, the angel comes back, this time not visiting Mary, but visiting Joseph and saying, Joseph, what Mary has told you is right and true. Do not divorce her, but take her as your wife. Because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit, not from any other man. And so Joseph takes her as his wife and accepts Jesus as his only son. Jesus came from humble beginnings. We find that Mary and Joseph were poor, common people. I mean, they weren't rich enough to reserve a room at the Bethlehem Holiday Inn, even. Right? They had nowhere to stay when they got there. They had no clout. They were humble people, and from those humble beginnings, Jesus is born. There's no pomp and circumstance at his birth. There's no royal decree. Right? We aren't even British. And when they have a baby over there, it's on all our channels, right? You can't get away from it. But there was nothing like that for Jesus. The business of the city of Bethlehem did not even stop to pay homage to him. He was born in a cow stall, maybe even a cave. And the only place to lay him down was in a place where animals eat. The King of Kings, the one who left the glory of heaven, he had no home, he had no bed. Outside of Mary and Joseph, the only creature who even knew he was there were the cattle, the cows, and the sheep who had to step aside so they could lay down. And so thinking about that story caused me this week to think about the births of our children and grandchildren. Think about that for a moment. Remember the excitement and the joy at the births of those little babies. Remember the pats on the back and the congratulations. Recall the hospital. Maybe there's even smells that come to mind when you think of it. Remember the doctors and nurses who were going in and out. Maybe there were things that perhaps weren't funny at the time, but now that you look back on it, several years removed, you chuckle at how those things happened. For moms, you remember the pain meds and the epidurals, right? The situation surrounding the birth of Jesus couldn't be more different from our births today. And yet, when we stop and we think about the children themselves, we find that the desires we have for our children, I think, are the same desires that Mary and Joseph had for Jesus. The hopes and the dreams and the expectations that we have for our children are the same hopes and dreams that Mary and Joseph had for Jesus, that God had for Jesus when he sent him here. And so let me share with you three thoughts that I think are important lessons that we can learn from the story of the birth of Jesus that mirror in some ways our own children, but are taken to a much greater, much higher level. The first is that we want our children to make a difference, do we not? We want our children to live lives that make an impact on people, that make changes in the world. I can remember after graduating from college that I was talking to a friend of mine. I said, you know, I just want a job where I got a desk and I can kick back and put my feet up on. And so I started working at the bank where I couldn't kick my feet up, but at least I had a desk, right? And I soon realized, I hate this. And part of the reason I hated it was because I wasn't very good at it, right? If you're supposed to be making loans and you don't have any loans coming through, the bank doesn't really like that. So they don't like you just come in and sit around. But the bigger reason for why I didn't like it is because I felt like what I was doing didn't mean anything. It wasn't helping anybody. It wasn't making a difference in the world. I felt like I was putting people just heaping more debt upon people rather than helping in any way. And so because of that, we've told both the boys that their careers shouldn't be based on money, although we have also told them that they do need to make enough to have a big enough house so that Sheila and I can move in at some point when we get old. But But it shouldn't be based on money, but it should be based on what they're passionate about and how they can bring good and change to their world. Well, just like we want our children to bring change to the world, Jesus brought change to the world. We looked at this in depth a few weeks ago when we looked at It's a Wonderful Life. Because we said It's a Wonderful Life because Jesus brought change to the world. We saw how without Jesus there would be no education and no hospitals. It's quite likely there would not be a United States of America, or at least not in the way that we know it. We know that because of Jesus, change came to the way women are looked at, to the way children are received and perceived and cherished. They're not just property. They're valuable, loving human beings that God has created. And Jesus came into a world in which Rome was the ruling power. And the culture of Rome was something that we would not wish on our worst enemy. I mean, the head of Israel, the Roman head of Israel, was this man Herod, right? Herod, who after Jesus was born was so paranoid, was so mean and vicious, that he decreed that all boys 2 years old and younger should be killed in hopes that he would kill Jesus. Herod, the man who killed multiple wives and several of his own sons. This is the world in which Jesus was born. And it was through his birth that the world changed. And Jesus made a difference and still is today. And so we celebrate the Nativity story because it is the story of a baby being born. And just as we long for our children to make a difference, we find that Jesus already has. Second thing is that we long to hear our child's name. When a baby is born, and over the last 2 or 3 weeks, we've had 2 new babies. Again, I want to clarify like I did in first service. We have had 2 babies. We have had no babies. Okay? Just clarifying that. But when a baby is born, we ask lots of questions, right? Is the baby doing okay? Is mom doing well? How much did they weigh? The baby, not mom. Don't ask that question. How long is the baby? All those numbers, right, we want to know. But then we get to the most important question. What is the name? And for some parents, they know the name before they're even old enough to have children. And they keep it a secret. And don't let anybody know until the baby's born. Some, they bounce all over the place. Oh yeah, this name sounds great. Oh no, don't like that name. And they're all over the place. Some say, I haven't a clue, I'll know the name when I see their face. But names are important. Later in life, do we not like it when people say our children's names? At least when it's in a positive sense. We love to hear our son's name, our daughter's name. Think about it. We're proud when we hear the name of our child. One of the greatest aspects of the birth of Jesus is that a time is coming when everyone will say his name. Now that might sound odd to us, to some of us. I mean, you know, here we are, we got this baby who was born in this small, nothing little village called Bethlehem. How in the world are people going to say his name? We've got this baby who was born who doesn't even have a home. Why in the world would everybody say his name? We got this baby who's born in a cattle stall. Most of the people in the town around him don't even know he's there, let alone say his name. What are you talking about? That at some point his name is going to be proclaimed. Now this is what I'm talking about, Philippians 2, 9-11. Therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name. That at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. A time is coming when every knee will bow and every tongue will confess Him as Lord. They will not have a choice. They will not have a choice. No matter how they've responded to Jesus in life, no matter what decision they made or didn't make, their knee will bow and their voice will proclaim the name of Jesus. For you see, God has taken this baby who was born into nothingness, into humble beginnings, who had to sleep his first few nights in a feeding trough. God has taken him and has exalted him to the place that is above all places. He sits on the throne. And the next time he comes back, he won't come back as a baby, but he comes back as a conqueror, as the ruler, as the victor, and as the king. And when everybody sees that, they will not be able to help themselves, and they will fall to their knees, and they will proclaim him as Lord, and they will shout the name of Jesus. Everybody will proclaim his name. We love the names we give our children, right? Some of you have given rich, meaningful names to your children. They're special to you. But no matter what the name of your child is, it pales in comparison to the name of Jesus. His name is above all other names. In Acts 4, verse 12, the disciples respond to the Sanhedrin and they say, "There is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved than the name of Jesus." We celebrate the Nativity story because it's about a baby being born. A baby they call Jesus. A name that will be proclaimed by all. And thirdly, we desire our children to have a purpose. We probably have all been there in some way, shape, or form, whether as the parent watching our child or as the child himself or herself, where we've gone through a stage of life where we seem to just be kind of wandering. We didn't know where we wanted to go. We didn't have any sense of purpose or direction in life. Maybe we were that young man who bounced from job to job because he thought this was fulfilling, but it didn't, so he went here to this, and that didn't work, and he was searching for something, and those weren't filling that. Maybe it's the young woman who just refuses to grow up and mature. Maybe it's the one who ventured off trying to find himself. We probably have all experienced it on some level. But as the parent, watching your child do that, it can be very painful, because we want our children to have a purpose, and to have meaning, and to know where they're going in life. We want them to know who they are and whose they are and what they are to accomplish. Going back to my college days, I can remember that. You know, I didn't know what I wanted to do, and I felt like I was just kind of wasting time. I even thought about just dropping out and, you know, waiting until I understood what the next step was. And as a parent to Caleb and Joshua, I want them to have purpose in life. I want their life to have meaning. I want them to know who they are and whose they are. Well, we find that the Nativity story is that Jesus had purpose. He knew who he was. He knew what he was to accomplish. I mean, just look at throughout the Gospels. How many times does he say, "This is not my time"? That's what he said to Mary before he changed the water into wine, right? He said, "Woman, it's not my time yet. I know what my plan is. I know what my purpose is." And you're kind of jumping the gun a little bit. He said, "I'm here to do my Father's will." And how many times does he say that throughout the Gospels? But it all started even before he came to this earth. Because when Joseph has the encounter with the angel, in Matthew's account of the birth story, the angel comes to Joseph and he tells Joseph that Mary's story is right and true and that he should take her as his wife. And then he says, "Joseph, you are to give him this name, and it is the name Jesus." And he doesn't give him that name because God really likes that name. He doesn't give him that name because in 4 BC that was the hip name to give babies. He says, give him the name Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. His name was Jesus because his purpose was salvation. He came so that we might have life and hope and peace, so that we might know what love really is, and that we might be able to express what love really is. Jesus came to fix what was broken. This past week was the last week for preschool before Christmas. And so there were Christmas programs. And I got to do chapel for all three of them. And so I brought three basketballs in. And I called three teachers up. And for the first two chapels, there was one teacher who didn't know what was going to happen. And so I gave two basketballs to two teachers, and then the third one, obviously, to the third teacher. I don't know why I said that, but anyway. And so the point was for them to bounce the basketballs, and I was playing along to see how many times they could bounce it and so forth. Well, so the first two I gave basketballs that were regular, that were full of air. The third one, I gave one that wasn't inflated fully, but I didn't let her know that. And so they started bouncing, and they're bouncing, you know, and this one over here is bounced, is throwing it down, and doesn't come back up. Pick it up, throw it back down, doesn't come back up. And the other two over here bouncing, 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 and I say, oh, hey, what'd you do? You broke my basketball, all this kind of stuff, you know. They're kids. But my point was that the two basketballs full of air worked and functioned as they're supposed to. Right? Basketball's supposed to bounce, supposed to come back up to you. This third one didn't function as it was supposed to. It didn't work properly. Because without air, basketballs don't function like they're supposed to. So we are basketballs without air. We are broken, sinful people who don't work as we were intended to work. We don't do what we were made to do. The basketballs that were filled with air, they did function properly. And so Jesus came to be our air. He came to help us bounce properly. He came to help us function and to live as we were originally intended to function and live. As I close, I want you to look at the last thing that Luke says in his account of the story. And he simply says there was no room for them in the inn. Now, you've probably seen some of those trivia, Christmas trivia things, right? That asks, what did the innkeeper say to Mary and Joseph? And the answer is nothing, because there's no innkeeper mentioned, you know, blah, 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 those kinds of things. But there's lots of questions and wonderings about what actually took place as they knocked on the door, and why did someone not let them in? But the point of it is that no room was made for Jesus. It doesn't matter what the innkeeper said or didn't say. It doesn't matter if there was an innkeeper or not. The fact is, no one made room for Jesus. And we live in a world that still today refuses to make room for Jesus. So my question is, what about you? Have you made room for Jesus? There's a painting, and actually we have a little, someone pointed out to you, the middle stained glass up there refers to this as well. There's a painting that shows a garden scene, and it's got a door, and Jesus is on the outside, and if you look at the greenery, the way it's been painted, it forms the shape of a heart. And it's in the middle of it, then, is this door. And Jesus is there, and he's some knocking on the door. Now, the interesting thing is, and most people don't notice this, is there's no door handle on the outside. Jesus can't get in. And what that says is that it's a picture of Jesus knocking on the door of our hearts. And he's not going to bust down the door. You know, he's not going to just make us open the door. He's waiting for us to open. In Revelation 3:20, Jesus is speaking. He says, I stand at the door and knock. He who opens the door, I'll come in, and I will eat with him. And so that picture is Jesus knocking on the door, wanting to come in, desiring that we would make room for him. And so the question is, will you open it? Will you make room for him? And not just this week, not just on Thursday, but in your life. Will there be room for Jesus in your life? Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for Christmas and the Nativity story and the birth of Jesus. And we thank you that he changed the world. We thank you that his name will be proclaimed by all. We thank you that he came with a purpose, and that purpose was to fix what was broken. I pray that this week, next week, each week, this season, and every season, we all would make room for Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand together as we close out our worship service this morning.